These beautiful saltwater crocs once reached over 8 meters in length. That's 28 feet. That's monster. At the Darwin Crocodile Farm, I met Anne Palmer.
I think the success of the crocodile really has a lot to do with the environment that it lives in. They live in semi-aquatic freshwater and saltwater swamps of the Northern Territory. They don't tend to have many predators, certainly no competition for the big animals. They can survive for long periods of time without food, but they are a very opportunistic feeder, taking horses, cattle, even human beings if they wander into that territory.
What about their hunting strategy?
A crocodile is a very efficient predator. A large croc will stalk their prey, dive underneath the surface. At the last minute, the crocodile will lunge out, take the animal off and roll, which is called the death roll, and drown it.
There's no doubt that this qualifies as a very real monster reptile, but then also as one of the most successful type of animals ever to evolve on Earth. Crocs like this appeared about 150 million years ago, and they filled a niche and got it right. They're semi-aquatic, opportunistic predators, and because their habitat and the job they do in it is virtually unchanged, then they remain virtually unchanged themselves. And that's the key. You see, they are survivors. Not in a lost world, but in an environmental niche where they've reigned supreme. So if we have an aquatic prehistoric reptile living here, then why not in Loch Ness? Loch Ness sits in a steep-sided valley cut out by a succession of glaciers over the last few million years. In fact, only 10,000 years ago, this was one of the biggest ice cubes on Earth. So the origin of any species living here now has to be more recent. For instance, it was only after that ice melted that the ancestors of today's fish swam in from the sea. So what about those plesiosaurs? In the 1970s, these photographs taken by Dr. Robert Rhines attracted worldwide attention. They appeared to show a flipper of a plesiosaur-type animal, and in the flurry of excitement, the unknown creature was even given a scientific name by the eminent naturalist Sir Peter Scott. Nesoteras rhombotrix appeared in the highly credible journal Nature, and it means Ness wonder with a diamond-shaped fin. However, it didn't take long for some sceptical word wizard to point out that the name had a rather intriguing anagram. And it was later revealed that the images themselves had been computer enhanced. But what of the other photo evidence? There was still the most famous image of all, the surgeon's photo from 1934. NASA, those astro-scientists, took an intense look at the photograph and they gave it the thumbs up. But oh dear, in 1994, the last of the original gang finally broke their silence and revealed the whole thing as a hoax. The most famous Loch Ness monster ever was no more than a model mounted on a toy submarine. So much for mission control. The old surgeon was a scoundrel after all. But of course, people do see some pretty weird things. Loch Ness is famed for baffling phenomena. Curious waves and boat wakes, atmospheric distortion, mists and novel reflections of the light. These can all confuse and convince the casual observer. But what about the locals, people who live with the loch and are used to its fickle trickery? Every once in a while they see something, and maybe their accounts are a little bit more difficult to dismiss. And when you consider their stories en masse, there's a clue.
I thought, I have to keep this quiet was my first thing. Nobody believes that I've actually seen this. I can't have publicity for this. I can't tell anybody about it.
Out in this area here, I saw what can best be described as a boiling of the water. Not a dramatic boiling, just a little bubbly.
Something caught my eye.
In the middle of this disturbance, there were three shiny black humps. I mean, till the day I go to my grave now, I'll tell you, there were three black humps there. I don't care what anyone else says.
at the edge of the jetty, I could see that there was definitely something in the water.
And then it surfaced, and it was large. Looking into the setting sun, it was 10 o'clock at night, it was a silhouette effect.
And I can recall distinctly the chap saying, "It's eels." And I said, "It's not bloody eels, they're too big." And his wife said, "Well, I've not been in the bar."
I approached it and it was only just a couple of feet away from me in the water. I was looking down on it and it started to move. There was this wake coming from it, just little ripples of water coming from it. For such a big object, I was amazed that it didn't make more of a splash.
No dorsal fin, no flipper, nothing that you would relate to, say, like a killer whale or any of that sort of things, or a fluke or a tail, nothing. No.
I thought I hadn't seen what we think to be a humpback Loch Ness monster, but I thought I'd seen a crocodile.
Oh no, I've no idea. I've no idea.
There's something living in there, more than one.
And I can't relate it to anything that I've ever seen in any part of the world.
It's a crocodile or some sort of fish, I would say.
Quite a fascinating experience.
You see, the clue is, they're all seeing completely different things. Adrian Shine came to the lock in the 70s. He's been a monster hunter, but now he has a different agenda.
At Loch Ness, really, you've got two sets of people. You've got about 1,000 eyewitnesses who say they see unusual things, and they do see things that they don't understand. On the other hand, you have scientists who've studied the lock, and who say there is not enough food in Loch Ness to sustain large creatures.
Rather than trawl for Nessie, Adrian has spent a productive decade examining the life in this peaty pool to establish a better understanding of the food chains that support the loch's distinctive ecosystem.
Loch Ness is a cold water environment. The last thing that happened here was the Ice Age, and when we get right down to 200 metres, it's an Ice Age world that we're entering. So we are a lost world at the bottom of Loch Ness, but it's not Jurassic Park.
So there, a cold, Ice Age lost world. Not very promising for a sun-loving animal. And what about that food supply?
Loch Ness is a very impoverished lake. Several surveys are suggesting that there's only about 20 tons of fish in it, which would really only support about 2 tons of top predator in Loch Ness. And that's a problem for a resident population of large predators. So I wouldn't myself believe in any sort of reptile, Jurassic or otherwise, viable and living here.
So, for a whole population of big fish eaters, it doesn't look great. Especially for ones from the prehistoric past. This seems conclusive, but I wanted a final expert opinion. Dave, why couldn't the Loch Ness monster be a plesiosaur?
For one reason, we have a 65 million year gap between the last fossil record and the present day. There is no evidence for any plesiosaurs. Loch Ness can only have had animals in it in the last 10,000 years. Therefore, there would have to have been a population of plesiosaurs in the sea somewhere that got in to Loch Ness 10,000 years ago. We have no evidence for them. Also, the physiology would have to have changed. They would have to have gone from being marine aquatic animals to being a freshwater animal in a very, very short period. Also, a viable population would have had to have got in. This population would have to have been really quite large for it to be viable over the last 10,000 years. And I don't think that the productivity in Loch Ness is sufficient to have been able to feed all of those relatively large animals. And the other thing is, of course, that remember that plesiosaurs were air-breathing animals. And for a large population to, a viable population to have been there, you would have been seeing plesiosaurs at the surface breathing every few minutes. Sadly, the Loch Ness phenomenon is not a plesiosaur.
So, let's try and pull it all together. Firstly, there's not enough food in this loch to support a population of large predators, reptiles or otherwise. In fact, Loch Ness, in human terms, is like a great big supermarket with three lettuces and one can of salmon left on the otherwise empty shelves. Secondly, the spices. Even if they had seen the last monster on the morning when it died, we now know that for a population of plesiosaurs to have survived into historic times, there would have needed to be at least 5,000 individuals. Now, people have been trekking up and down the side of this loch for hundreds of years, keeping detailed records. And yet, there's no mention of a veritable forest of long necks and tiny heads. So I'm sorry to say, there is no Loch Ness monster. For the very simple reason that there's never been a population of them. But hey, just because there's no monster doesn't mean that there's never been anything in here. There has, and there always will be. Because the loch is open to the sea. There's a way in the River Ness. Salmon swim and leap into the loch to spawn, and sometimes larger animals such as seals follow them in. There's also the Caledonian Canal, and although there were locks to negotiate, animals could make it through. And as far as Adrian Shine is concerned, at least some of the historic sightings could be explained by one particular visitor.
Loch Ness is a body of water that's open to the sea, and that's where all our fish came from. And a local tradition says that a strange fish was in Loch Ness. So what about strange fish? And you know, there is a very rare visitor to Britain, would enter fresh water only to spawn. There's really the largest fish you would ever see in fresh water. In fact, it's a Baltic sturgeon. And they've run up British rivers 70 miles or so, past locks and weirs. And what I'm suggesting really is that the original tradition could have begun with the occasional entry of a sturgeon vainly seeking a mate and then leaving no trace save an enigma.
I'm pretty convinced that sturgeon account for at least some of the ancient encounters. They can grow to 7 meters, often swim near the surface, creating long wakes, and with their prominent scales, they do look very reptilian. But a fish wouldn't be crossing the road. So what did the spicers actually see? Well, real animals do visit the loch, and they probably did so with a much greater regularity when these folks were around. And I've no doubt they saw something. Perhaps, I don't know, perhaps they got an unusual or really distorted view of a couple of otters running across the road, disappearing down the bank into the water. Who knows? Seals, porpoises, all kinds of unexpected animals probably pay fleeting visits to the loch. So, is that it? There's not one Loch Ness monster. There are many. Amongst the jumble of hoaxes and media hype, there are different people interpreting different things in different situations. At its cynical worst, the modern Loch Ness monster could be described as nothing more than a boy to the local tourist industry. But even that wouldn't work if it wasn't such a fantastically romantic idea. We'd all like to think that Nessie was out there, even I would, but it isn't, for the very simple reason that there's never been a population out there. Population is the key word. What there is, a curious loch phenomena, visiting animals, and too many people looking too hard. But hey, I know exactly whatever I say won't ever stop any visitor to the loch from slowing down, taking a look over the water, and hoping to see something a little bit too strange to be true.
The Bigfoot's next week's ex-creeper was the famous film for real or a hoax? Chris investigates at the same time, 7 o'clock. Next tonight on BBC One, a new series of Tomorrow's World with the technology that could save your life.